Iceland is a young land. A land of ice and snow and rock and volcanoes. And fire.
I noticed on the seismograph, which is real time, a really tight knit graph of earthquakes above 3, above 4. I was just about to write to Gary when he says, "Johan, I think there's something going on."
My name is Gary Greenbaum, and I am the Chief Operating Officer at NatureEye. I've been here for several years now.
My name is Shawn Willsey. I'm a geology professor at the College of Southern Idaho. And I first came to know NatureEye through an email that was sent to me introducing the company, explaining what they were about, that they had drones that could be remotely operated by users in various places around the world.
You know, we've been flying flights out of Iceland for the better part of a year, and so it was really just connecting some dots. Can we do some flights at this unique location and give people even a once-in-a-lifetime experience of flying real-time over an active volcano?
Yeah, so I became aware of some of the geologic unrest in Iceland in late October, and by early November, I started doing regular updates on my YouTube channel. So while I was going to be looking at what was happening from a scientific point of view, I thought it would be helpful to share that with other folks that might be interested, and started putting together probably almost daily or at least a couple times a week updates on the geologic situation that was taking place there, looking at the earthquakes, looking at the ground deformation, and then, you know, coming up with different scenarios that might play out.
And we were flying from where we do our regular flights down there, which is from Faradalsfjall volcano.
The first live stream was exciting. It was, if I remember right, it was a live stream. We flew over the area that ended up erupting, but we were there the day before it erupted, which was just really crazy, fortuitous luck, I suppose, that we were there. You know, we didn't know it was going to erupt the next day, but we flew over that landscape and might have been, I mean, honestly, the last people collectively to look at that landscape before it was drastically transformed by that December 18th eruption.
Nobody really expected Reykjanes Peninsula to wake up.
So the eruption was on Sunday morning, around 7:30. I got word around 8:30 on my phone that we should head out immediately. And I assumed, because the eruption just happened, and of course a lot of uncertainty, where the magma was going to flow and where this thing might move, that they were going to really take us to a pretty remote area that was, you know, very safe, that had, you know, backups in terms of escape routes if necessary. But the reality was, they took us roughly to about 100 meters from where this thing was erupting. I was shocked how close we actually were. It was on one road, so there was one way out and one way in.
While we were flying over that large lava field, that main fissure from this eruption on January 14th, we were flying right over the vent. I mean, it was spectacular footage of the volcano erupting. But as we looked to the south towards the town, I could see there was a little just small dot, just a little red dot on the screen with a little bit of gas, of like a plume of gas as well. It looked like it had just started. And so we flew the drone down towards the south, and this was within 100 meters or so of a house that was there. And we actually were able to watch this second vent, this secondary fissure, open up, 100 meters or so from this house. The crack opening up in the ground, the volcanic gases rising, and then the lava coming up through the crack.
When we spotted that second fissure just above the village or town, everyone thought at that moment that the town was doomed. We stayed there until 7 or 8 p.m. and then they told us we had to leave. But when we arrived first thing next morning, it was a great relief to see that the lava field had actually stopped there.